Each is needed for the other to work in its fullness. Faith, belief in God, and belief in His Word, God breathed. God, who is love, breathed this Word. Therefore, this Word reveals what? The love of God. Everything is geared to us to understand Him so that we might what? Become holy as He is holy. To understand what that means and to realize we cannot get there. We can't even take the first step in our own strength. We need God's intervention, His Holy Spirit, to open our eyes to His glory and to His love and to His mercy and to His grace. He gives us the faith to believe. And then we have this picture of hope, a confidence. And I put here, not a wish, but an I know. This hope is not, I wish something would happen, but that I know this is going to occur. I know that if someone confesses with their mouth and believes in their heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that God raised Him from the dead, he shall be saved. I have a confidence that the God who has given us His Word will accomplish it, and He will keep it. And I wrote it this way on purpose. The God who is, He has no beginning, He has no end. The God who is eternal, He has given us His Word, He will accomplish it. Every single promise He has made in here will come to fruition. And that's a very personal thing for each and every one of us, because He says, and for each and every one of us that have confessed Him, He is going to complete the work He has started in us. We will be holy and able to be in His presence eternally because of what He has done for us. All His promises. Going back again to the book of Romans, I was looking at chapter 8, and just since I left off on chapter 7, there is no, verse 1 of chapter 8, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In other words, we're outside of the judgment. There's no condemnation. Even though we have this battle going on with the flesh, who's going to deliver us? Christ Jesus, the Lord. And as a result, God looks at us and does not, the condemnation has been put on Christ. He has paid it all. And as a result, I am resting in Him. I think of the song that we'll be singing at the end. It says, "Why should I gain from His reward?" The song that we sing for communion today. I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. It was His sin it was my sin that held Him on the cross. It says, held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. When Jesus said it was finished, it was done. I don't have anything to bring to it. He has paid it all. And it's a done deal. It's finished. It's accomplished. There's nothing to add to it. You look in Romans, again, chapter 8, you look at verse 11. The Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. When does that happen? At the point of confession, the point of salvation, God's Holy Spirit dwells in us. He who has raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. This is a promise. For all who are led to the Spirit by the Spirit of God are sons of God, or children of God. We've been adopted as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father, which means we have a personal, intimate relationship with Him. Heirs of God, joint heirs with Jesus. All of these promises I love the picture of God's love worked out in Zechariah chapter 3. It says, then he showed me the high priest Joshua standing before the angel of the Lord. This isn't Joshua of Exodus. This is Joshua, it was a common name. He showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord. Who's the angel of the Lord? Jesus. If it said an angel of the Lord, it would, but the angel of the Lord is Jesus. And it says standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. So Joshua has, he's standing before the Lord, and at his right hand is Satan. And Satan's getting out his list, and you know, I look at it like one of those rolls of old printer paper, you know, and he just comes down, and he's got this list, and he says, I know this guy. I know everything that he's done. Okay, and he's ready to be there. He is the accuser. It says, standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire? Satan didn't get to read any part of his list. God says, rebuke you for even coming here to interfere with this. In a sense, he says, you have no business here. Now Joshua, again, was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments, and the angel said to those who were standing before him, remove the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments. And I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord was standing by. What a powerful picture of God's grace and mercy. What did Joshua deserve? Everything that was on that list that Satan had that was ready to accuse him, Joshua was guilty. But God took his wrath, his judgment, became a propitiation, brought peace before the throne of God on behalf of Joshua. And as a result, he says, and it's in that picture, I think of, you know, Satan, you know, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. It would be us kind of saying, get behind me, Satan. You keep throwing up my old sins at me that I brought before the throne of God and asked for forgiveness and have received forgiveness, and they are done deal. I've come under the blood of Christ, and they're gone. I don't need to go fishing them out of the deepest part of the sea where God put them. Satan would like us to. Finishing up here, I'd like to go back to the book of Romans one more time. Romans chapter 5. Paul writes, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. It's such a powerful picture. Again, faith and hope, mercy and grace, patience and kindness, all the things that go with this. It originates with God, and God wants it to flow through into us and through us to other people. And people will say, they will know we are Christians by our love. Jesus, that's what he told the disciples. Continue in Romans chapter 5. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. These promises, we can rest assured, will be all accomplished. Everything that he is saying here is true. It's by faith that we believe in it. We have the hope that it will be all finished and accomplished. And again, it's not a wish form of hope. It's a definitive, I know that I know. I'd like to ask the ladies to come back up and share the song that we have, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. As we have prayer for communion. If you want to open the communion things, again, I think most of you are familiar with it now, but you pull the tab down and it releases that little thin film that exposes the bread. And then you pull up on that tab and it opens the cup to the juice.
Oh,
Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, as he talks about the Lord's Supper, he says, I have received from the Lord, but I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Father, again, we come and say thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the word, it is the words, it is finished, coming from the cross. We receive that as grace accomplished, salvation purchased, allowing for all who confess and believe they might be saved. We ask, Lord, that you would cause us to take the scriptures that we have today and rest in them in such a way that you would strengthen our walk with you. Encourage us, Lord, to be in your word, to be in prayer, to be in thanksgiving on a regular basis for all that you have done. We worship you, we praise you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we close, I just want to share one more passage. It's found in Colossians chapter 1. This is how we are to approach our pursuit of God. One of the ways that is mentioned in Scripture. Paul is speaking to the Colossians, and this is he is praying a prayer of thanksgiving and thanking the Lord for all that he's seen in the Colossian church and all that's happening. And he adds to this, he says in verse 9 of chapter 1, so from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will, in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Now, if I put that in the right understanding, say increasing in the knowledge of God, it takes me right back to verse 9, being filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom, and to walk in a manner worthy, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit. It's called the Colossian cycle. And it's a never-ending cycle in our life with Christ as we seek him and his word and growing in who he is. It's a lifetime investment of studying his word. And the only other thing I want you to see is the awesomeness of who he is from the same chapter, chapter 1, the preeminence of Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. People say how things hold together. I look at this piece of wood and I say it's solid wood, but you realize that there's neutrons, electrons, and all these weird things moving around in it. And I don't understand how that happens, and they want to come apart, but they can't because something's holding them together. I believe this is what I just read to you, that all things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. It's his word that holds all things together. And he is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. Not that he was created in any way, but firstborn from the dead, meaning that he is the one that has all the rights of the firstborn child. In the Hebrew culture, that means that all is his. He inherits everything from the Father, and then he shares it with us so that we can say from Romans, we are joint heirs with Jesus. That in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Amen. Would you stand as we close, and let's have a quick word of prayer. Father, we ask that you would go with us, cause us to be the people of your kingdom that you ask us and want us to be. Give us your eyes, your ears, your sensitivity, that we would see things that we need to reach out to in the world around us to show your love and your mercy and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen.